So let's think about this. We've started at the end and we've said the goal is to get, you know, perfect absorption of the most broken down elements and the most fundamental forms. So this is a problem with the malabsorption. So let's walk up the chain a little bit further and say, how do we get maximum, most efficient breakdown of food in the digestion process so that the absorption part can happen? This is where I think people, they think it's complicated and it's really not, and they don't understand how powerful eating to optimize the digestion, the chemical process of the breakdown is with the food combining thing.
So the first step is chew efficiently. And some people say you should chew at least 15 to 20 times. You really just need to chew until that food is actually a liquid. That's how long you need to chew. And that could be 10 chews. And most people, and I know I do it myself, something could be so delicious or we're in a hurry or we're talking while we're doing it that we eat too fast. And mothers do this a lot because they're so busy. You know, they've got such a bad habit of eating quickly before the baby wakes up or before the kids need you, that you tend to eat too fast and your food doesn't digest. So chew very well. That's the first process. Otherwise, the chemical process is not going to be as efficient. And then you need to be not mixing proteins and starches at the same time to make sure that the hydrochloric acid activates the pepsin and there's no fermentation taking place, and that way the proteins will digest properly and the carbohydrates will digest properly when there's no proteins with them. And then to make sure that your digestive tract, well, from that point on, everything will work efficiently if the hormonal system is working properly. Now, that's a whole other can of worms or kettle of fish that we call can of worms going to open, because the endocrine system controls the release of all the enzyme in the digestive tract. So while you're getting your endocrine system on track, you may find that you need to take digestive enzymes with every meal, because you may find that food combining and things like that may not – they may improve your digestive tract, but not as much as you'd like it to do. So you may initially need digestive enzymes while you get the endocrine. And the endocrine system needs natural fats, and it needs exercise, and it needs lots of natural vitamin C from raw fruits and vegetables. But there again, if your digestive tract is clogged up with all this muck, you've got to clear out the muck first. Otherwise, you're not going to be able to absorb all of that stuff. So everything is so interrelated that you've got to start with, like, let me chew my food properly. Let me not mix proteins and starches, and let me eat whole foods. Whole food, plant-based diet. And if you're eating a bit of chicken or fish every now and again, don't panic about it. Just don't mix it with carbohydrates. That's what's important.
Let's dig into this, because this is where people – I remember 25 years ago I was food combining, and it was radical. But I mean, it was, people were like, I can't eat a sandwich. And it was like, well, here's, it's really simple, but it changes the way that you prepare food, the way that you present food, the way that you eat food. A concentrated protein in a category is basically animal products, right? If almost any form, assume it's a concentrated protein. Nuts and seeds are qualify for your concentrated protein because it was over 15%, right?
Yeah.
What else is high in protein that would be common?
A lot of people would think that legumes like beans, garbanzo beans, you know, kidney beans, bellotti beans, they would think that those are actually a concentrated protein, but they don't contain more than 15% protein. Most of them contain somewhere around 3 to 8%, so they're really not considered a complete, or not necessarily complete, they're not considered a concentrated protein. So okay, they could be starches or proteins, and they may digest well.
Okay, so let's say that a concentrated protein, if you're eating any of those things at one time, What we're saying is you cannot digest that food and get the optimum breakdown into the base units that your body needs to absorb if you are also trying to eat a concentrated carbohydrate, which would be grains or sugars or anything in that category, right?
Absolutely.
It's that simple. So a turkey sandwich is a bad idea, not because – if turkey's bad for you, I mean, there's all sorts of arguments. What we can say is a turkey sandwich is bad for you because the majority of the food, the majority of that sandwich will not get digested and broken down and just stick around in your body as toxin.
Yeah, absolutely. And then,
it's fundamental.
Yeah, that's it. And if you had an avocado sandwich, it'll digest way more efficiently.
because you just have to decide, do you want to eat the carbohydrate or do you want to eat the protein at that meal? And that's really the fundamental decision is you could eat a roasted veggie sandwich and it would be a completely different scenario because it's not a concentrated protein. Or you could eat a salad with your turkey and you would at least digest the food correctly because you're separating, and it's basic chemistry. This is not weird voodoo. This is not bizarre. You can't put a base and an acid together and remain a base or an acid. It's going to neutralize or at least hit the middle part of pH, and anything above 3.0, the protein's going to rot. It's not going to break down. Anything above 4.0, the carbohydrates are going to ferment and rot. So this isn't Marianne making this up. This is just basic chemistry. Your body is
in your basic physiology textbooks. If you take any good physiology, like Guyton's, for example, you know, on page 784, I forget, it depends on which edition you have, it'll tell you that carbohydrates digest at a pH optimally of above 4, and then, you know, 6 pages later, it'll tell you proteins digest at an optimum pH of below 3. It's there in the textbooks. Nobody bothered putting them together. So nobody's saying, well, carbohydrates are exactly what you're saying, pH over 4, and proteins above 3. Nobody's putting together and say, well, you can't have them in the digestive tract at the same time. You're going to end up with fermentation.
So But people do eat it. The argument generally is, but people have been eating this way for a long time. And the answer is, well, your body's amazing. Your body is doing an incredible amount of compensation. And you are dealing with a massive amount of dysfunction because of undigested food. People have been doing it for years and dying of all sorts of diseases and maldeficiencies because their bodies are not digesting correctly.
Yep.
Safe to say, right?
The people that digest their food the most efficiently are people that eat very sparingly and very little. People that maybe eat once a day or twice a day, never snack in between, never eat junk food, will find they can eat a protein in starch, but they're eating, you know, a piece of meat like that and a little potato and this much vegetables, and they have a tiny plate of food and they chew very carefully and very slowly, and then you have them digesting their food efficiently. So if you're eating tiny amounts, chewing very well and eating very slowly, chances are you're not going to have this digestive discomfort.